risen. You shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witness in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Let us confess our sin against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive us all our sins through Jesus Christ our Lord. Strengthen us in all goodness by the power of the Holy Spirit. Keep us in eternal life. Amen. Lord, open our lips, and our mouth shall proclaim your praise. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. The Lord is risen indeed. Come, let us adore him. Hallelujah. Come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout for joy to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving and raise a loud shout to him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hands are the caverns of the earth, and the heights of the hills are his also. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands have molded the dry land. Come, let us bow down and bend the knee and kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Oh, that today you would hearken to his voice. A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom of Israel? He replied, it is not for you to know the time or periods that the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going, they were gazing toward heaven, and suddenly two men in white robes stood by them. They said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up toward heaven? This Jesus who has been taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. Then they returned to Jerusalem from the Mount of Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey away. When they had entered the city, they went to the room upstairs where they had been staying. Peter and John and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew, Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus, Simon the Zealot, and Judas the son of James. All these were constantly devoting themselves to prayer, together with certain women, including Mary, the Martha of Jesus, as well as his brothers. The word of the Lord. Psalm appointed for this morning is a portion of Psalm 68. May God arise, may his enemies be shattered, may his foes flee before him, may you blow them away like smoke, as wax melts before the fire. May the wicked perish before God, but may the righteous be glad and rejoice before God. May they be happy and joyful. Sing to God, sing in praise of his name. Extol him who rides on the clouds. Rejoice before him. His name is the Lord. The Father to the fatherless, the defender of the widows, is God in his holy dwelling. God is lonely in families. He leads out the prisoners with singing, but the rebellious live in a sun-scorched land. When you, God, went out before your people, when you marched through the wilderness, the earth shook, the heavens poured down rain. Before God, the one of Sinai, before God, the God of Israel, you gave abundant showers, O God. You refreshed your weary inhabitants. Your people settled in it. And from your bounty, God, you provided for the poor. To him who rides across the highest heavens, the ancient heavens, who thunders with mighty voice, proclaim the power of God, whose majesty is over Israel, whose power is in the heavens. You, God, are awesome in your sanctuary. The God of Israel gives power and strength to his people. Praise be to God. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Our epistle is from Peter's first letter to the churches in Asia Minor. Dear friends, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that has come on you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice inasmuch as you participate in the suffering of Christ, so that you may be overjoyed when his glory is revealed. If you're insulted because of Christ's name, you're blessed. The Spirit of glory of God rests on you. Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. Cast out all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you. Be alert and sober of mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Resist him. Stand firm in the faith, because you know that the family of believers throughout the world is undergoing the same kind of suffering. And the God of all grace, who called you to this eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. In him be all power forever and ever. Amen. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to St. John. After Jesus had spoken these words, he looked up to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, so that your Son may glorify you. Since you have given him authority over all people, to give eternal life to all whom you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I have glorified you on earth by finishing the work that you gave me to do. So now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had in your presence before the world existed. I've made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they've kept your word. Now they know that everything you've given me is from you, for the words that you gave me I have given to them. And they have received them, and know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I'm asking on their behalf. I'm not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I'm no longer in the world, but they're in the world, and I'm coming to you, Holy Father. Protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one. The Gospel of the Lord. Our Gospel lesson this morning is taken from the prayer of Jesus on the night before his arrest and trial and conviction. Matthew, Mark, and Luke all tell the story of Jesus and his disciples in the Garden of Gethsemane near the Mount of Olives. Only moments before he'd been betrayed by Judas and arrested. You remember how Jesus asked some of his disciples to watch and pray, and then Jesus went off and prayed by himself. He comes back and he finds the disciples asleep, and he wakes them up, and again he challenges them to stay awake and pray that they may not fall into temptation. And then he goes off and prays again. He returns a second and a third time, only to find the disciples asleep each time. The account of Jesus' prayer in John's gospel is totally different from anything we find from the other gospel writers.
I don't know
why, except that John the evangelist always seems to be more interested in feeding our hearts and nourishing our souls than simply recounting facts. You know, it would seem that if everyone but Jesus was asleep, that no one would have known what Jesus prayed. And so we can only assume that the writer was inspired to write what he did in this morning's lesson. Or maybe Jesus shared this event, the event of his prayer, with John sometimes after his resurrection, during those 40 days before his ascension. I wish that this morning's reading had included the entire 17th chapter, because if we look at Jesus' prayer in John's gospel, we find that he prayed for himself, that he and the Father would be glorified. In the portion of the gospel assigned for today, we hear Jesus as he then prays for his disciples, those who were going to be left behind after his death, resurrection, and ascension. Then if we had to read on, we would hear Jesus pray for all those who would believe after having heard the message of salvation. And it was at that time that Jesus prayed for you and me. Nearly 2,000 years ago, Jesus prayed for all who would hear and believe, and that includes you and me. Father, just as you are in me and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe, and may they be brought to complete unity. There's that prayer for unity within the church again, something that we pray for each Sunday after we've gathered around the altar. Somehow Jesus knew that his church would need that prayer in the days and the years to come. And here we are 2,000 years later, and the church still needs a prayer for unity. Jesus also talked about being in the Father and the Father being in him. Not with, but in. Just like the Holy Spirit dwells in each of us, not just with us. Jesus also talks about bringing glory to the Father through his obedience to God's will. Jesus, I have glorified you here on earth by finishing the work that you've given me to do. The climax of Jesus' ministry was to be the cross. And it was on Calvary that Jesus was to be glorified. Jesus said, I finished the work that you gave me to do. How many of you can say that this morning? How many of you are attempting each day to do the work that God has placed before you? For years I've preached to congregations that God has a plan for your life, and I believe that. But will you be able to stand in the presence of God one day and say, I finished the work that you had for me? I followed your plan for my life. That's what Jesus wants from each of us. I believe that too many people today may find themselves standing before God and having to say, well, actually, I did it my way most of the time. You know, that may have worked for Frank Sinatra, but that's not what God expects from his chosen ones. Only days before, Jesus had said to his followers, the hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Disciples hadn't understood what Jesus was talking about. But in the days to follow, they'd recall his words, and they would understand. By his death on the cross, Jesus showed that there was nothing that the love of God was not prepared to do, to suffer for the sake of mankind. There's simply no limit to God's love for his creation. God allowed his only begotten Son to endure the agony of the cross because of his love for you and me. Children always honor their parents when they're obedient. Citizens honor their country when they observe the laws. A student brings honor to his teacher when he follows their instructions, and Jesus glorified his Father through his obedience to God's will. And you and I are called to that same obedience. You know, Jesus didn't have to die on the cross. He could have chosen not to go to Jerusalem. He could have done that. He could have simply gone on teaching and healing and doing good works. Jesus, like you and me, had a free will. He could decide to follow that will of God or not. He may have never stopped, you may never stop to realize, but aren't we glad that he chose to glorify himself and his Father by being obedient to his Father's will? You know, the cross only proved that the worst that man could do to Jesus was nothing in comparison to what God was prepared to do for you and me. The glory of the cross was the resurrection. The worst that man could do to Jesus still didn't conquer him. And the glory of the resurrection obliterated the shame of the cross. Jesus said to his Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory that I had in your presence before the world existed. He said, glorify me with the glory that I had when the world began. One of the problems that some people have in understanding the Trinity is understanding that God the Father, along with the Son, and along with the Holy Spirit, have always been. Some people want to believe that God somehow created Jesus as a baby in the manger. And then they want to believe that the Holy Spirit was something that God created on the day of Pentecost. But that's hardly the case. The Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit have always been, since time as we know it. Jesus had obeyed the will of the Father, and now he could return to the Father in triumph to enjoy the victory, the victor's glory. He could return to the glory that he had left behind when he came down to earth as man. That was Jesus' prayer for himself. Then in verse 6, Jesus began to pray for his disciples. He said, I've made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They received your words and know in truth that I came from you. Made your name known to those you gave me. To know God is a concept that is sounded throughout the scriptures. All of this boils down to the concept that we must know God in order to have a true life. And Jesus said, I've made your name known to those whom you have given me. It's through Jesus that we come to know what God is like. There's obviously an element of intellectual awareness in knowing God, knowing what God is like. But there's something else even more important. In Genesis, we read that Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bore a son. And the word that's used here is the same word, to know. Adam and Eve were no longer two, but they were one flesh. We're talking about the intimacy of the heart and mind and soul, which in true love is to know God. Not merely intellectual knowledge of him. It's having an intimate personal relationship with him. It can be the dearest relationship that you can experience. But without Jesus, this kind of intimacy with God might be unthinkable. Jesus called God Abba. That doesn't mean father, that means daddy. And that's the relationship with God that we're offered through Jesus' death on the cross, through his obedience to the will of God and through his resurrection. Jesus said, I've enabled men to see what the real nature of God is like. Chapter 14, Jesus had said, he who has seen me has seen the Father. It was Jesus' claim that in him we could see the mind and the character and the heart of God. Jesus prayed for those who would be left behind. You know, one of the things that's still hard to understand is how in the world Jesus would entrust history, the future of his earthly ministry, to 11 Galilean peasants, fishermen, laborers, a zealot, a tax collector, two brothers who were known as the Son of Thunder. Who knows how they got that name? It was a motley crew at best, and yet Jesus trusted them to carry on the ministry because through him they'd come to know the Father. Jesus had two things, believe in God and believe in men. Think about that. Jesus put his trust in people just like you and me to carry the work that he had begun. And we too believe in God and in one another. Then we too are capable of doing mighty things in his name. What followed was the arrest, the trial, the crucifixion, and the resurrection of Jesus. And then 40 days later, after that first Easter morning, Jesus would return to be with his Father. during the Sundays after the Easter season, we've been looking at some of Jesus' appearances to his followers. How he appeared in their midst in that closed room and said, "Peace be with you." How he showed Thomas his hands and his feet and his side and challenged Thomas to put his doubts aside and believe. We've heard how Jesus entrusted the responsibility of proclaiming God's forgiveness of sin to these men. And then John ends his gospel with a fishing story. As Jesus and his followers returned to their roots one more time and shared a meal of fish by the water's edge. And for one last time, Jesus instructed Peter and his disciples to follow him and feed his sheep. That may seem to be a rather strange final request, since Jesus was about to leave this earth, and it would be impossible to follow him in that regard. But then we began to look at Luke's record of the Acts of the Apostles. We might see in Luke's Gospel's writing, he had written about Jesus. He had written about all the things that Jesus had done and said. He had recorded the story of Jesus' passion, and he had related the events occurred following his resurrection during those previous 40 days. And if I'd been Paul Harvey this morning, this is what I'd say, and now you'll hear the rest of the story. The Gospel of Luke is the story of Jesus. The book of Acts is the story of the founding of the church, the spreading of the gospel, the beginning of the early New Testament churches, and the evangelistic efforts of the apostles and Paul and their followers. The theme of Luke's writing may be found in the 8th verse, where we read, "You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." And it begins with those who had followed Jesus for the past 3 years. The lesson says that they were standing outside the city, gazing into heaven. Last Thursday was Ascension Day, 40 days after Easter morning, when Jesus returned to the Father. 10 days later, his followers were to receive the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost. We'll be celebrating that wonderful occasion next week when we traditionally wear red and remember the tongues of fire that were witnessed in the city of Jerusalem. But let's think for a moment about Jesus' ascension. Now, there have been all kinds of discussions concerning what actually happened. As Luke described, he was lifted up and a cloud took him out of their sight. The important thing is not what happened. It's not even what's important of how it happened. We know what happened. We may not understand how. But we know that somehow Jesus returned to the Father and to the Father's glory. But what we need to look at for this moment, this morning, is what happened to those who were left behind. And Luke tells us that they were left gazing into heaven. I suspect they were still trying to figure out what had just happened. Jesus had done it to them again. For the last 3 years, Jesus had repeatedly told them everything that was going to happen. How the temple would be destroyed and then restored in 3 days. How he would leave them, but how he would send a comforter to be with them. How they'd not be able to go with him, but they could do all things in his name. And now Jesus had instructed these Galilean peasants to go into all the world and preach the gospel. It said, "You will receive power from the Holy Spirit, and you'll be my witnesses." And then he disappeared. Can you imagine what was going through the minds of these men? There's a certain amount of awe and wonder, I suspect. But there's also got to be a sense of excitement and eagerness. They've just been commissioned by Jesus to go out in the world and proclaim the good news. But I imagine that all this was tempered with a good dose of plain old fear. What in the world have we gotten ourselves into? It's one thing to follow Jesus, it's something else altogether to be sent out on your own to spread the good news. And Luke tells us that while the apostles were standing there gazing into the sky, two men in white robes appeared to him and said, "Why are you standing around here? Why are you looking up into heaven? Go back to Jerusalem and wait." We see the disciples being instructed to wait. And for 10 days, the disciples and others devoted themselves to prayer and waiting. They waited and they prayed for 10 days. Can you imagine what might happen, what we might be able to accomplish in a church if we were to come together and pray for 10 days and wait on God to reveal himself to us? I wonder if it was during this time of waiting that Peter began to sense that there'd be times of suffering during the months and years to come. When he would later write his epistle, he said, "Don't be surprised if the fiery ordeal is taking place among you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you." Peter said a Christian is to be different from other people, and it's human nature to be suspect of anyone that's different. So if we're doing our job as Christians, the world may be offended, and the outcome may be predictable. You know, if you're not experiencing some discomfort in your daily life, it could be that you're not being the kind of witness that you were called to be. And Jesus promised each of us a peace that would pass us all understanding. But he also told his followers that following him wouldn't always be an easy task. Jesus was glorified on the cross in his obedience to God's will. And Peter suggests that you and I be glorified if we suffer because of our attempt to also be obedient to the Father. All of us have heard in recent weeks of this pain and the suffering that's occurring due to the coronavirus. People not just here at home but around the world have died and are dying. But I don't for a minute believe that God wants any of his children to suffer or die because of their faith in him. Some of our politicians would want us to keep our doors closed indefinitely because they see the church as being non-essential. But while our patience is truly being tested daily, this is a time to remember Jesus promised to be with us. And he sent his Holy Spirit to dwell with us. The good news for us this morning is that we do have the Holy Spirit living in our lives. The Comforter sent to us by Jesus. And he is with us and he is in us during these times of isolation. And we too have God's promise that we'll share in Christ's glory if we're faithful to God's will in our lives. Jesus said, "Holy Father, protect them in your name, so that they may be one as you and I are one." That's Jesus' prayer, and that's the Father's promise. We're called to be obedient. We're called to live in unity with our fellow Christians, and we're called to proclaim the good news to the ends of the earth. That's our challenge. The question is, how are you responding to that challenge? Remember, God loves you, and so do I.
So join with me. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived with the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Save your people, Lord, and bless your inheritance. Govern and uphold them now and always. Day by day we bless you. We praise your name forever. Lord, keep us from all sin today. Have mercy on us, Lord, have mercy. Lord, show us your love and mercy. We put our trust in you. And you, Lord, is our hope. And we shall never hope in vain. O God, the King of glory, you've exalted your own Son, Jesus Christ, with great triumph in your kingdom in heaven. Do not leave us comfortless.
but send your Holy Spirit to strengthen us and exalt us to that place where our Savior Christ has gone before, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God in glory, everlasting. Oh God, you make us glad with this weekly remembrance of the glorious resurrection of your Son, our Lord. Give us this day such blessing through our worship of you, that the week to come may be spent in your favor through Jesus Christ our Lord. O God, King of the universe, whose light divides the day from the night and turns the shadow of death into morning, drive far from us all wrong desires, incline our hearts to keep your law, and guide our feet in the way of peace, that having done your will with cheerfulness during the day, we may, when night comes, rejoice to give you thanks through Jesus Christ our Lord. O God, the author of peace and the lover of concord, to know you is eternal life and to serve you is perfect freedom. Defend us, your humble servants, in all assaults of our enemies, that we, surely trusting in your defense, may not fear the power of any adversity, through the might of Jesus Christ our Lord. Lord Jesus, almighty and everlasting God, you have brought us in safety this new day. Preserve us with your mighty power, that we may not fall into sin, nor be overcome by adversity, but in all that we do, direct us to the fulfilling of your purpose, through Jesus Christ our Lord. O God, you made in one blood all the peoples of the earth, and sent your blessed Son to preach peace to those who are far off and to those who are near. Grant that people everywhere may seek after you and find you, bringing nations into your fold. Pour out your Spirit upon all flesh and hasten the coming of your kingdom through Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you stretched your arms on the cross in loving wood, that everyone might come within reach of your saving embrace. So clothe us in your Spirit that we, reaching forth our hands in love, may bring those who do not know you the knowledge and love of you, the honor of your name. Amen. Let's observe a moment of silence as we pray for loved ones and those who need our prayers this morning. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us, to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love and the redemption of the world by your Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Almighty and ever-living God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, hear our prayers for this parish family. Strengthen the faithful, arouse the careless, and restore the penitent. Grant us all things necessary for our common life. Bring us all to be of one heart and mind within your holy church, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let's bless the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Lord, please show me every day as your teacher.